KOA radio. Yes, and he was assassinated by an unknown group for years, and later it was found out that the group was this group, neo-Nazi group called the Order, which had operated up in the Northwest, but had tentacles that went out to a lot of different areas, and it eventually ended up, by a very circuitous kind of series of events, assassinating this man in Denver. His talk radio programs were real controversial. He was known for really kind of provoking all kinds of heated conversations about a range of issues. But one of the issues that they had been dealing with was the situation with the Holocaust and the new neo-Nazis, and that had been something that had recently been discussed right before his death. So what this playwright does is he weaves two stories together. One is the story of the trial of these men that were members of the Order and one woman who were arrested for a conspiracy that included the murder of Alan Berg and also a lot of robberies and other kinds of crimes. So what you do is you hear the testimony basically of one main witness testifying about the Order, and then intersperse pieces of talk radio shows with Alan Berg. And then gradually he takes all of this and kind of merges it together, so at the end it all comes together. But the way it's done, it requires a lot of staging in a way to make those transitions from one thing to the other. So I'll try to keep you posted. If it looks like, you know, a transition's going to be hard to understand, I may butt in and just say that's what's happening here. Now we're moving back in time or forward in time. Maybe any problem with it, but we noticed reading it the other day, after doing it, that it was a lot more confusing just to be read than it was when it was staged. Because, of course, you have lights and all kinds of things to isolate incidents so you can tell what's going on. So if you're confused, just raise your hand and I'll try to clear things up for you. Today, there will be people reading a lot of different roles, so also be aware of that. One actor may be reading two or three different parts. And usually those characters are fairly easy to distinguish, but sometimes it's kind of hard to make that jump. So if you're confused, it's probably because they're in a different character. And again, I'll try to fill you in if that looks like it's going to be a problem. Did anybody see the show? Oh, good. So some of you did. I know you guys did it. Yeah, good.
Will the photo flash be disturbing?
Gosh, I don't know. If it got in their eyes, it might be hard to read, but I would say probably it wouldn't be a good idea. In case it flashed in their eyes, it'd be hard for them to read. Is everyone, are the other actors here? Any questions for me?
Was the movie talk radio based on Ellenberg's?
Yes. And those two pieces don't have any, this piece and that piece don't really have anything to do with each other, except that they were both based on the same incident. Yeah, they fictionalized it and took it, I think, out of Denver to
New York, I think.
Yeah, some other town.
What's the title of the play?
It's called God's Country, yes.
Wasn't it the Order that did the robbery of the armored car that they bought the vehicles here in Santa Rosa?
Right up in Ukiah. As a matter of fact, they met in Santa Rosa and then the robbery, they were arrested right near Ukiah.
Near Lake? Clear Lake?
What motivated you to pick this particular play?
Me?
Yeah.
That's a good question. I was up in Ashland at the Shakespeare Theater up there, and this play was running in the big theater in Ashland, and I had no idea what it was about. No idea. Somebody had said it was something about racism, and that was a subject I was interested in, so I went to see it thinking, and then somebody else said they thought it was about South Africa. Anyway, I got in there and was completely shocked to find out that this was not a story about some foreign country or some historical event, but actually something that had happened, you know, right near where I live. And I thought it was a really riveting play, you know, real different kind of what you ordinarily see. And there was a lot of discussion afterwards, and I just wanted to come back and do it, you know, on campus, just to kind of give people a chance to have the same experience I had, and the students here. We have people from a lot of different groups come for the discussions afterwards.
And who are you?
My name is Elizabeth Craven. I teach in theater arts here.
Yes, I have thought I recognized you, but I wasn't sure. No other thing.
Okay.
I missed you. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Are we all here? Excellent. Okay, so we'll just start. Thanks. Hi, Heather. And then when you're not reading, just sit down. Absolutely.
Should I just stay here for the great
yeah.
We're sitting down?
Yeah. We should be... We never had a chance to rehearse in here. Little improvised here at the beginning.
There's the parliament, we've got some of the last movies. That's the place to go.
Who else is kind of offering that?
No, you can sit down when you're not reading.
We practice this.
We're not racist, but we play one in your classroom.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
U.S. District Court, Seattle, Washington, 1985.
The government calls Mr. Denver Parmenter. Mr. Parmenter, when you started college at Cheney in Eastern Washington, did you have any particular political view of any kind?
Yes, at that time I had pretty much what you refer to as a conservative point of view or right wing, very much in support of Ronald Reagan's candidacy.
And over the years you were at Cheney, views change in any way?
Oh, yes, they did. They became more to the extreme right and eventually became very radical.
Did there come a time in the summer of 1981 that you became aware of a group located nearby in Idaho by the name of Aryan Nations?
Yes.
And how did you react to your first visit to Aryan Nations?
Very positively. I talked to Pastor Butler, who was the pastor of the church.
Mr. Parmenter, was there anything different about the philosophy or beliefs you encountered at Aryan Nations as opposed to the right-wing views you had held before you went up there?
Yes, it basically brought Christianity into the overall philosophy of the right wing and the fact that the white race was considered to be the true Israelites of the Bible.
Is there a shorthand name for that belief that you're aware of?
Identity. It's normally referred to as the identity doctrine.
Directing your attention to approximately September of 1983, did there come a time when you began discussing with Robert J. Matthews future political activities of any kind?
Yes, we came to discuss the white movement's non-activity as far as actually doing some of the things we'd been talking about. And we began to discuss the possibility of setting up an organization to begin showing force.
What action did you take in that respect?
Bob Matthews decided to form the organization. He got some people together and we met.
And what happened at the meeting?
Well, Bob had a set of goals and objectives for us. We agreed upon them. We took an oath and formed the order.
Did the name The Order come from any particular publication that you're aware of?
Probably the Turner Diaries.
And what were the Turner Diaries as you understood them?
The Turner Diaries was a book written by William Pierce under a pen name. And it's a blueprint to revolution by the white movement.
You said Matthews had an outline of goals he presented to the group?
Yes, they were referred to as steps. The first two I'm not really sure of. They were just forming the group, setting the goals. But The third step was the war chest.
Meaning what?
Acquiring money to finance the group. Robberies basically were stressed as the most viable way.
What was step four?
Step four was recruiting members for the organization.
Was there a step five?
Yes. Step five was assassination.
Now, you mentioned that in the initial meeting and taking of an oath.
Yes.
Would you describe what occurred in that respect?
Yes, we all gathered in a circle. A child, a baby, was placed in the middle of the circle as a symbol of our race, the future of our race, of what we were fighting for. Bob Matthews normally would recite the oath, and we would repeat it after him.
I, as a free Aryan man, hereby swear an unrelenting oath upon the green graves of our sires.
Upon the children in the wombs of our wives.
Upon the throne of God Almighty,
sacred be his name.
To join together in holy union with those brothers in this circle.
And to declare forthright that from this moment on no fear of death.
No fear of foe.
That I have a sacred duty to do whatever is necessary to deliver our people from the Jew.
And bring total victory to the Aryan race.
Mr. Parminder, you said that you were in and out of Aryan nations. Why was that?
Because of the situation with my wife.
I, as an Aryan warrior, swear myself to complete secrecy to the order.
And total loyalty to my comrades.
My wife did not agree with the philosophy of Aryan nations.
Let me bear witness to you, my brothers.
That should one of you fall in battle, I will see to the welfare and well-being of your family.
Plus, I was having drinking problems.
Let me bear witness, my brothers.
That should one of you be taken prisoner, I will do whatever is necessary to regain your freedom.
I was trying to satisfy my wife and also satisfy my own personal beliefs.
Let me bear witness to you, my brothers.
That should an enemy agent hurt you.
I will chase him to the ends of the earth.
And remove his head from his body.
On the occasion of the first meeting of the order, was your wife present?
Yes.
And your child?
Yes.
Let me bear witness to you, my brothers.
That if I break this oath, let me be forever cursed upon the lips of our people as a coward.
And what occurred with your child to the oath?
Bob Matthews wanted to use my child to be placed in the middle of a circle.
My brother, let us be his battle axe and weapons of war.
My wife refused.
Let us go forth by ones and by twos.
By scores and by legions.
What was your reaction to it?
And as true Aryan men with pure hearts and strong minds.
It was somewhat embarrassing to me.
Face the enemies of our faith and our race with courage and determination.
How did you feel about your child being placed in the center of the circle?
We hereby invoke the blood covenant and declare that we are in a full state of war. And will not our weapons until we have driven the enemy into the sea and reclaimed that land which was promised to our fathers of old.
Did you have any strong emotional feeling about a child being in the center of the circle?
And through our blood and his will becomes the land of our children to be.
I felt it would be an honor to have my child in the middle of the circle.
Hail victory!
Hail victory!
In 1983, Alan Berg was working at KO in Denver. He was the most notorious on-air personality working at the West's most powerful station. He was Jewish, he was liberal, he was bright, and he was outspoken, a bleeding heart with an acid tongue. At 50 years of age, the former Chicago lawyer had earned the nickname the Last Angry Man. One listener said, he had the ability to manipulate people into saying what they really wanted to say. That can be dangerous.
You see, when you make these indictments against the Jews, Mr. Farrell, one of the really nice things would be to have some facts available. And the facts are available if you care to look at them.
Well, we'd like to sit down and debate them with you.
Uh-huh. On June 15, 1983, Berg's program linked up via telephone with two avowed white supremacists, Rick Elliott, publisher of the Primrose and Cattleman's Gazette, which ran such articles as The Death of the White Race, and retired Air Force Colonel Bud Farrell. The show was prompted by the fact that U.S. Representative Patricia Schroeder had discovered the U.S. Marine Corps to be advertising in the Gazette. It was rumored that, using her influence on the House Armed Services Committee, she had the ads stopped.
Well, it's so simple, and far more valuable for you, right, let's say, the Holocaust Museum, right, let's see, the United Jewish Federation. Now, they'll send you all the information you want, with all the documentation, with the names of the Jews who died in World War II. You see, they documented this. This is reality. This is not a game. And I'd be the first to tell you that if we say 6 million, you know, somebody could have made a mistake. It could be 5, it could be 4, in fact, it could be 7.
It could be 2.
Well, is that really the issue, Mr. Elliott?
That's not the issue, except to say you people are making it the issue, trying to say why Pat Schroeder did what she did.
I think that Pat Schroeder was wrong, and I dramatically disagree with her. I think that Pat Schroeder owes us a phone call on this one. Now, she's a lady I have long admired. Hey, I took a pretty good fire in the face once from Pat Schroeder. at a fundraiser. So, for the pie in the face, I could get a call on this.
She's saying we're anti-Semitic, and that's not a
fact. Sir, that speaks for itself in the very comments you're making. You're not anti-Semitic. You're simply anti-Jewish.
I am not.
You are accusing the Jews of a world conspiracy to take away your Christianity. Now, that's not exactly a love affair with Jews, is it?
Alan, let me ask you a question.
Fortunately for the women out there, I'm not.
Well, say you're married. Now, could you be loyal to a wife and a girlfriend? How can you explain dual citizenship, then? How can you explain dual loyalty?
I don't think it's difficult to explain something like this at all. All you've got to do
You've got a country that's in trouble. The economy is in trouble.
Are you familiar with Israel's economy?
Well, there's hyperinflation.
Okay, how much inflation?
Well, I know it's much greater than ours.
Oh, would you perceive the Jew of Israel to be, you know, a rich person?
The figures I have say that every family in Israel got over $10,400 a U.S. taxpayer.
That is the most, sir! You will never see a more collective poverty and a merely getting along than you will in Israel. Now, I would urge you to take a trip to Israel, or take a look at how the average Israeli lives. They are living hand-to-mouth. Are you familiar with that?
I'm familiar with hand-to-mouth, but again, we're getting to the point of what we're talking
about.
But
see, you have accused the Jewish banker of this conspiracy, and here's the state of Israel barely getting along. It's unbelievable. You have to be there to see it. Now, let me urge you again, all right? If you want some facts instead of whistling Dixie...
I am not whistling Dixie!
You are whistling, because everything you've said here is a lie, okay? But I think you've got a right to advocate your lies. And I'm still protecting your right to lie, okay? As long as you lie, I like it out in the open like this. Because you see, you have no facts. You have made up and you have inferred a thought. Like all fanatics, like the John Birchers, like the Klansmen, like all those happy folks.
I'm crazy.
I'm crazy, sir. And you are a healthy person. Thanks so much for calling.
Yeah, I know you're above this. I know. I remember. 6 months ago, you stood at that window with a cup of coffee in your hand waiting for the sheriff, the man you sit next to at church. At that moment, you have two pictures in your head. Your grandfather showing you around the farm when you were a kid, and your son finding you in the barn with a gun loaded and cocked. You're standing there, waiting to give four generations away. Up the road comes a couple of pickups you don't recognize. Five of them, dressed like you, carrying rifles. They knock on your door and you open it. We've heard they're trying to take your farm away from you. Nod. They put themselves in front of your door, rifles in hand, as the sheriff drives up. The sheriff takes a step towards your farmhouse. The rifles take aim at his face. One of the men you do not know says, "An illegal seizure of this man's personal property. As citizens at war with an occupational government, we refuse to acknowledge the authority of this county to confiscate this man's farm." You expect sheriff's reaction to be the same as yours. What the hell is this? The sheriff takes another step and begins to speak again. One of the other men puts it a different way. Take one more step and we'll blow your fucking head off your shoulders. Is that clear? The sheriff looks in the eye, turns, and leaves. As the men lower their rifles, you begin out of what? Habit? Instinct? To thank them. You invite them in. But they are already coming back in their pickups. You ask their names and they say they'll be in touch. They drive away, leaving behind the words, "illegal seizure, occupational government, and citizens at war." You're left standing there and your kids rush out the door and head for school. And you begin to pay attention. The news looks different to you now, as does your land, and your son, and your God. You're not an evil man. You have found refuge. Somewhere between the evening news and the Sunday sermon, you have found your country, and your hatred has become your logic. You've turned a corner, haven't you?
July 1985. In a courtroom guarded by 18 armed U.S. Marshals, the criminal enterprise known as the Order is brought to trial. The defendants' chairs are bolted to the floor, and machine guns are hidden throughout the courtroom to be used in the event of a riot.
Several former order members, including Denver Parliament, plea agreements and testify against the other defendants in exchange for leniency.
The government brings racketeering charges against 9 men and 1 woman. They are
Richard Kemp, 22, known to his fellow order members as Hammer. They like to play a well-known Beatles song in his honor. Kemp earned the name Hammer after the group decided something must be done with their friend Walter West, who had trouble remaining both sober and secretive. Under the guise of inducting West into the order, Kemp and 3 others walked him into the woods. Kemp took a hammer and shattered West's skull. When West, still conscious, cried out, "What's going on?" he was hit with his own gun and placed in a shallow grave. His brains were retrieved and buried with his body.
Randy Dewey, 34, the man who coolly finished off Walter West with a round of bullets. After this incident, Dewey was given the name Luke, based on a Paul Newman movie.
Bruce Pierce, 30, called Brigham due to his strange resemblance to Mormon founder Brigham Young.
Gary Yarbrough, 30, the only defendant with a previous criminal record. His red hair and mustache earned him the name Yosemite Sam.
Frank Silva, 27, known as Sterling. He operated the order's secret message center.
Frank, 57, the only woman defendant. She did surveillance for the group and was the mother of Robert Matthews' 20-year-old mistress, Zilla. Jean Craig was called Rainy because of her tendency to burst into tears.
Randall Evans, 29, a former California Klan member who helped plan the order's most successful robbery. He was called Calvin for no apparent reason.
Andrew Barnhill, 28, former member of CSA, the Covenant Sword and Arm of the Lord. Barnhill was called Mr. Closet based on a remark he made where members of the opposite sex should be kept.
Artie McBrearty, 57, though he went to during his trial to deny it, he was known as the Professor. He created the homemade voice stress analyzer test, which was used to test the loyalty of certain recruits.
And David Lane, 48, the often brilliant, often brooding, former Denver Klan leader. He was known as Lone Wolf.
Opening statements, Mr. Ward.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm one of 6 U.S. attorneys who will prosecute this case on behalf of the government. They're going to hear a name, you're going to hear the name Robert Matthews an awful lot during this case. Robert Matthews is no longer living. He died last December on Whidbey Island.
I soon settled down to marriage. Clearing my lands, and reading. Reading became an obsession with me. I consumed volume upon volume on subjects dealing with history, politics, and economics. My knowledge of ancient European history began to awaken a wrongfully suppressed emotion buried deep within my soul, that of racial pride and consciousness. The stronger the love for my people grew, the deeper became my hatred for those who would destroy my race, my heritage. The more I came to love my son, the more I came to realize that unless things changed drastically, by the time he was my age, he'd be a stranger in his own land. I came to learn that this was not by accident, that there is a small cohesive group within this country working day and night to make this happen. A secret war has been between the regime in Washington and an ever-growing number of people who are determined to regain what our forefathers discovered, explored, conquered and died for. Until now, we've been doing nothing more than growing and preparing. The government, however, seems determined to force the issue.
There is simply no question that Matthews was the founder and leader of this group called the Order. These defendants, each and every defendant in this case, at various times during late 1983 or 84, joined the movement. There will be evidence that to a certain extent this group patterned itself after the racist group in a book known as the Turner Diary.
My client objects.
So do I, Your Honor.
This is an opening statement. It is not evidence in the case. The jury's been so advised.
The government expects to prove each and every count that's set forth in the indictment.
Mr. Chappell.
Thank you. I represent Jean Craig. She is the one woman in this case. The evidence is going to show that Jean Craig was not a young militant. The evidence, ladies and gentlemen, is going to show that the order was a man's world and a woman did not have a voice. What this case is centered on is the testimony of a few people who have entered into what the government will call plea agreements. And what those really are, plea bargains. You give me what I want, and I'll give you what you want. Ladies and gentlemen, these witnesses are merely puppets of the government. Toys. There'll be strings from the hands, strings from the head, hinges on the jaws. One of the things the government has talked about is the death of Alan Berg, the Denver disc jockey. And he died, ladies and gentlemen, in a mafia-style execution. The evidence is going to show that Alan Berg was one of the most hated men in America and that there were many people who may have wanted to kill him. I want to talk about Whidbey Island. The government has indicated in its opening remarks that Robert Matthews died in a fire.
The government has not told you much about the evidence of what happened on Whidbey Island. But this is what the evidence is going to show. And I'm going to tell you right now that the FBI killed Robert Matthews.
Your Honor, I object. There's no such evidence. Mr. Chappell knows that.
Again, it is an opening statement. It is not evidence of any kind. Mr. Phillips.
Mrs., thank you.
Thank you.
I am the attorney for David Lane. No one is on trial for what they said or what they wrote. No one is on trial for their beliefs.
Mr. Halpern.
I am involved in this defense with Artie McGreery. The government is going to suggest that these people are neo-Nazis, but what they're not going to tell you is that Mr. McBrady volunteered in World War II to fight against the Nazis. The government is going to suggest that Mr. McBrady and others here are racists. They are not going to tell you that during the time he is in, he's been teaching Bible class to blacks and Hispanics. You have heard that the order frowned very heavily on race mixing. Well, Mr. McBrady's son is married to a Filipino woman, an Asian. They have two children, Mr. McBrady's grandchildren, who are half Filipino. That's very curious behavior for a racist. Very curious indeed. The fact is that Mr. McBrady wasn't even contacted by any of the people involved in this whole mess until after all of the big, exciting crimes had already been committed. What is going on here? The government's idea is to make all of these people into one group. They're hoping that after you've sat through, 200-300 witnesses, that none of the individual defendants will stand out in any way. A person accused of murder will begin to seem morally identical to someone accused of walking across a state line with some money. The efforts of the government will be a little like tuna fishing. You take your boat out into the ocean, you drop your nets out, and whatever happens to come up, whether it's a big tuna or a small tuna, it's a dolphin that normally swims in the same waters. The fisherman makes no effort to separate the dolphin from the tuna, the baby tuna from the adult tuna. It all ends up in the same net. It all ends up equally dead.
At this meeting with Mr. Matthews in Boise, did he show you anything that related to obtaining false identification?
Yes, he did. He showed us a list of, quite an extensive list of the names of dead babies that were acquired for the use of getting ID.
Explain where the list had come from?
Yes, he said the girls had acquired it, that they had done the groundwork for it.
How would these names be acquired?
By going to graveyards, and I assume this was one of the ways that he did it, by going to graveyards and getting the names off the tombstones.
And once you had the name of an infant that died, what would you do with it?
The name of the dead infant would be used to acquire a death certificate. Once we got the death certificate, the vital information we needed to get a birth certificate was ours.
Matthew Mark Samuel.
David Zimmerman.
Step four was recruiting members for the organization. We were hoping we could recruit members from the various right-wing organizations, such as the Klan, other identity churches, any right-wing movement we could find that would be helpful.
The list reads like a litany.
American Nazi Party.
Arizona Patriots, Aryan Brotherhood.
Aryan Nations.
Aryan Youth Movement.
Groups that espouse violence.
Brutish Wagon Task Force 2.
Chicago Area Skinheads.
Denounce the IRS.
Christian Patriots Defense League.
Church of the Creator.
Civilian Material Assistance.
Confederate Strike Force Skinheads, Confederate Vigilante Knights.
Groups that harass and intimidate.
Covenant Sword and Arm of the Lord.
Duck Club.
Farmers Liberation Army.
Guardian Knights of Justice.
Young and old.
Invisible Empire of the Ku Klux Klan.
Knights of the Ku Klux Klan.
National Association for the Advancement of White People.
National Democratic Front, National Socialist Liberation Front.
National Socialist White People's Party.
National States Rights Party.
East and West.
New Order Knights.
Posse Comitatus
South.
Socialist Anarchist Nazi Remnant.
Socialist Nationalist Aryan People's Party.
SS Action Group.
Teenage Commando Squad.
United Clans of America.
Some advocate separatism.
White Aryan Resistance. White Knights of Liberty.
White Patriot Party. White Student Union.
Some advocate extermination.
Let us pray.
There is one common bond for the majority of these groups, a set of religious beliefs known as the Identity Doctrine.
Mr. Parmentier, could you further describe what you came to know the Identity Doctrine to be?
Yes, it was, like I said, basically that the white people were the Israelites of the Bible. They produced a real antagonist by saying that the Jews were the progeny of the devil, and that it was the responsibility of the white race to destroy the race of Jews, and also to separate themselves from all other races.
We believe the Bible is the true word of Yahweh, our God, written for and about a specific people.
The Bible is the family history of the white race, the children of Yahweh placed on earth through the seed line of Adam.
Ameri, meaning heavenly.
Rica, or Reich, meaning kingdom.
America.
Heavenly kingdom.
In May of 1920, Henry Ford began to use a part of his automobile fortune and began to publish a document called the Protocols of the Learned Elders of Zion. These protocols, which Ford claims were issued at the first Zionist Congress in 1897, were said to be the writings of Jewish elders concerned plan to take over the world. Ford, to prove his theory of a Jewish conspiracy, had the protocols printed in the Dearborn Independent throughout the 1920s. They were then collected in book form and entitled The International Jew, the World's Foremost Problem.
They were distributed by every Ford dealer in America.
Protocol number 11, Article 4.
The protocols depict the Jewish race as the cause of worldwide turmoil.
The Goyim are a flock of sheep and we are their wolves. And you know what happens when the wolves get hold of the flock.
The Jews are held responsible for communism, the Russian Revolution, the gold standard, the murder of Christ, and finance capitalism.
Protocol number 8, Article 2. We shall surround ourselves with a whole constellation of bankers, industrialists, capitalists, and the main thing, millionaires. Because, in substance, everything will be settled by figures.
It was later revealed that the protocols were not written by Jews at all. They were forged by the Dearborn Independence editor, William Cameron.
Protocol number 5, Article 11.
By all these means, we shall so wear down the Goyim that they fail to offer us international power.
Of a nature that by its very position will enable us, without any violence,
gradually to absorb all the state forces of the world and to form a super-government.
Though exposed and admitted to as forgery, the protocols are still readily available today throughout the radical right.
Protocol number 15, Article 1.
They used as a call to arms to the white race in its battle against Zog, the Zionist occupation government.
We shall slay without mercy all who take arms in hand to oppose our coming into our kingdom.
We believe there are literal children of Satan today.
These children are the descendant of Cain, who was born of Eve's physical seduction by Satan.
These people are a race of Mongolian Turkish Khazars, who are known in the world today as Jews.
We believe that the Canaanite Jew is the natural enemy of the white race.
This is attested to by scripture in all secular history.
William Cameron, who forged the protocols, went on to found the Anglo-Saxon Federation of America in 1928, which published Destiny magazine, the leading racist periodical of its day.
A California Klan member by the name of Wesley Swift was highly influenced by the magazine and began to incorporate these theories of a Jewish conspiracy into the white supremacist movement.
Swift founded the Church of Jesus Christ Christian in 1946 and traveled nationwide promoting its message.
Swift's original church in Lancaster, California was inherited by a man named Richard Butler.
Butler moved the church to Hayden Lake, Idaho in the early 70s.
Where it continues to this day.
We believe that the true literal children of the Bible are the 12 lost Israel.
Ancient Israel followed the reign of Solomon, was divided into 12 tribes named after the 12 sons of Jacob.
Jacob was the son of Abraham. He was not a Jew.
After the Exodus from Egypt, God gave each of the 12 tribes a place in the promised land. In 585 BC, however, the tribes were conquered and run out of the area by the Assyrians. They then became known as the 12 lost tribes of Israel.
Although there is no further mention of these tribes in the Bible, it has been historically proven that these tribes remained intact and left Assyria by Caucasus Mountains.
And the descendants of these people are known to this day as Caucasians.
The tribe of Ephraim became Great Britain.
The tribe of Benjamin became Iceland.
The tribe of Gad became Italy.
The tribe of Reuben became Holland.
The tribes of Zebulun and Judah became France and Germany.
The tribes of Issachar and Naphtali became Finland and Norway.
The tribes of Dan and Asher became Denmark and Sweden.
And the tribe of Manasseh moved across the Atlantic on the Mayflower and were given sacred documents called the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, and the Bill of Rights.
A Mary, heavenly.
Rica, or Reich, meaning kingdom.
This tribe became known as the United States of America.
Heavenly kingdom! The government calls Mr. Peter Lake.
A California writer and filmmaker who infiltrated the Aryan Nation's church in 1983, around the time that the order was being formed. Lake took numerous videotapes of order activities and later wrote an article for The Rebel, a short-lived published by Larry Flint.
Mr. Lake, are you familiar with the book entitled The Turner Diaries?
Yes.
Would you open that up and tell us if you recognize the contents?
Yes, I do.
Now, did there come a time when you had a discussion with the defendant, Frank Silva, about the Turner Diaries?
Yes, he said, you should read it, partner. It's all there. Everything that's going to happen is in the Turner Diaries.
Did you read the Turner Diaries?
I didn't read the Turner Diaries then. I couldn't find a copy. Everybody was telling me to read it, and I couldn't find a copy to read.
Did you finally read it?
Yes, I did.
Who is listed as the purported author of the Turner Diaries?
Andrew McDonald.
Do you know, in fact, who is the author?
William Pierce.
Who is William Pierce?
Your Honor, I'll object. He's laid no foundation.
Lay a foundation, please.
How do you know that William Pierce wrote the Turner Diaries?
His copyright is on the inside page.
Do you know who William Pierce is?
Yes, he is the head of a group called the National Alliance based in Washington, D.C. He's said to be an ultra-right-wing organization.
I will object to that, said to be and asked to be stricken.
So ordered.
What was your understanding of the National Alliance?
The National Alliance is a far-right-wing organization.
I object to that. There is no foundation.
Overruled, this is a statement.
Do you know where it is headquartered?
Washington, D.C.
This book, The Turner Diaries, does it purport to be a book of fiction or nonfiction?
It is fiction. 1991, The Turner Diaries describes the United States as being under the control of oppressive elements, Jewish-controlled, black-controlled elements, who have corrupted the government and virtually enslaved the citizens of the United States. A counter-revolutionary secret group called the Order attempts, through various means of assassination, counterfeiting, revolutionary violence, to overthrow the government of the United States, beginning on the West Coast. During an apocalyptic moment called the Day of the Rope, they hang media people, judges, senators, anyone in authority is killed.
Keep going.
And gradually, the Order takes over the country. That the hero, Earl Turner, finally dies in a nuclear attack on the Pentagon. He is seen as a hero, the martyr.
And the application.
And the implication is that the movement. And the implication is that the movement will then spread beyond the shores of the United States to include the whole world.
Mr. Halperin.
Did any of these people that you met at the Aryan Nations Church have relatives of mixed racial background?
Not that I knew.
Do you think it was very likely?
Not likely at all.
What do you think are the chances that someone who would have Filipino grandchildren and a Filipino daughter...
Objection! Going for speculation!
I think Mr. Halperin's entitled to ask this question before you interrupt.
Sorry.
After he asks this question. If you have any objection, you may certainly make it.
What do you think are the chances that one who would have a Filipino daughter-in-law and Filipino grandchildren would be a member of this group?
Objection! Calling for speculation.
Why don't you ask him if he saw them?
Did you see any such people?
No.
And what did the sign say at the front entrance?
Whites only.
No further questions.
This is 861 Talk, 861-8255. You're on the air.
I've got a few things I'd like to say about Jewish people. I myself am a Christian, okay? But Alan, some of the best people I've ever known in my life are Jewish people. They've been close friends. They're warm.
No, I don't think that means anything. I don't think it has anything to do with anything in this argument.
Yeah, well, it's important that that be said.
I don't think it is important. I think it's nonsensical, stroking, almost anti-Semitic.
Oh, they're proud. They're hardworking. And as businessmen, they'll clean your plow in a free enterprise
system. Now,
don't
forget that the Jews have their own fashion of being clannish and prejudiced. It's a part of living. We cling to our own. We're afraid of indifference is the way we learn more.
I've not called before, but I've been so riled up and disappointed in the kind of people there are in the world, it really makes me sick.
Now see, when you hear voices here, don't think that these are rare voices. These are representatives of tens of thousands of people.
It just shakes me up so bad that people can turn their back on the Holocaust and say it didn't happen.
It will never happen again.
It will never happen again.
The only place I could see the same thing happening again, though, is here in the United States. The only reason that I'm fighting for Elliot, if you want to call it fighting for them, is that it always scares me if we do anything to interfere with the freedom of expression. It always ends up hurting the minority. Now, Rick Elliott has just advised us that, in fact, he's had a threat in his life based on what we've discussed here on the air. This, I think, is a valid point to bring up here. This is not the way to handle it. This is usually done to me. Now, I'm always getting the threats on my life. This is not going to solve anything whatsoever. Now, I don't like what Rick has to say, and I don't like what Colonel Farrell had to say, but we're discussing something here, people, and hopefully we're going to make some sense in it. Now, I'm in no way advocating, or have I at any time in this show, violence against these people or anyone else who doesn't agree with me. To the callers out there who threaten them, you're all wet too.
Because of the negative publicity generated by the show, most of Rick Elliott's publishers, advertisers pulled out. This cost a man named Dave's job at the newspaper.
I was run out of Denver by the Jews media.
Lane would lay awake at night listening to the Berg Show.
You had a pretty rough day today.
Lady, I didn't have a rough day.
Yeah, well, you had a pretty lively day.
My dear, dealing with people like this is like dealing with duck soup.
Hey, you're gonna have a John Birch Society after you.
Oh, God.
David Lane made tapes of Berg's conversations with members of the radical right.
While I agree with you fundamentally that the guests you had appeared to be bigots, I have an objection to the way that you handled them.
Well, you go right ahead.
You tend to dominate your questions, and you act more like a prosecuting attorney than a moderator.
I am challenging the prosecutor.
He's a filthy Jew.
I'm giving them the sources, and they're still screaming at me. You're wrong, Alden, you're wrong. Now, what kind of thinking ability is that? If you challenge people's beliefs, it's like pulling out the rug from underneath them.
Lane played the tapes of Berg's show for the Church of Christ in La Porte, Colorado.
Hello, Alan. How are you?
Better now? All right?
First of all, I just want to say that you make so mad sometimes I'd like to strangle you.
After playing the tapes, Lane spoke to the congregation.
I had one other thing to say.
Somebody.
Thank God for Alan Berg and the fact that you speak up like you do.
Somebody ought to shoot that guy.
We were discussing the possibility of doing a step 5 operation.
Meaning what?
Meaning assassination.
What individuals were designated or singled out as targets for assassination?
Henry Kissinger, David Rockefeller, the leaders of the three networks.
Why were the broadcast networks assisted?
It was felt the news media was one of the vehicles responsible for poisoning the minds of our people.
Anyone else?
Morris Dees.
And who did you understand Morris Dees to be?
Mr. Dees had some organization in Atlanta. He was monitoring white movement groups and harassing them. He's also Jewish.
Anyone else?
Norman Lear.
And who did you understand Norman Lear to be?
He was a television producer.
And why did the group think Mr. Lear deserved to be killed?
Well, he was a Jew. Plus, all of his programs were thought to be anti-white, and they were thought to be attacking what we considered to be white principles.
Were there any other names mentioned as possible assassination targets?
Yes, Alan Berg.
And who did you understand Alan Berg to be?
He was a radio talk show host in Denver, Colorado.
And why was he under discussion as someone who should be killed?
He had made some outspoken remarks or had some interviews with the white movement people. He was very belligerent toward the white movement. He was a very belligerent individual in general.
Was it a premise of the group to kill anyone and thought to be a belligerent individual?
No, he was mainly thought to be anti-white.
Talk like Russian roulette.
And he was Jewish.
When you push the button, you never know what'll happen.
Following the oath-taking at Robert Matthews' farm in September, members of the order commit their first crime on October 28, 1983. Matthews, Pierce, Randy Dewey, and Dan Bauer drive to an adult bookstore in Spokane, Washington.
We wanted to attack those things we thought were detrimental to our society. Pimps, porno stores, adult theaters, things like that.
Matthews, Pierce, and Dewey enter the store. Bauer waits outside in a getaway car.
Mr. Dewey related where he struck one of the clerks. He was amazed the clerk wasn't more stunned than he was. Apparently, he took the blow quite well. They tied the people up with tape and left the scene.
The porno store robbery nets the order $369.10.
November 1983. 6 order members traveled to Seattle.
The trip was intended to go over there and rob an armored car. That was our intention. Maybe not specifically an armored car, but we were intending to rob something.
The 6 men check into one room at the Golden West Motel.
We surveyed different locations, a Fred Meyer store and a Kmart. Fred Meyer store was voted to be the best possibility.
Now, while you were in Seattle, did you discuss any other illegal activities besides pulling a robbery?
Yes, Mr. Bauer had brought up a bit of news that was of interest to us, that a Rothschild would be coming to the area.
A what?
Excuse me?
A what would be coming to the area?
A Rothschild. I can't remember his first name. We understood that he was to be a banker from France.
That would be a Baron Rothschild.
Yes.
Well, Mr. Parmenter, do you know, in fact, that he was a banker?
I think he was a banker, yes.
Well, the banker might not have been a banker, correct?
I said, I think he's a banker.
I see. What was the meeting all about that he was coming to?
I'm not sure. I don't recall.
Well, who was he talking to?
The best I can recollect it was a meeting of... It was some type of Jewish religious type meeting.
And I understand that you went to the University of Washington and you went to the library and you looked up a publication, is this correct?
Yes, Mr. Bauer and I looked up in a Jewish publication and we found out that he was going to have his meeting at the Four Seasons Olympic Hotel in Seattle.
Is that in downtown Seattle?
Yes.
What did the hotel look like?
It was very big, it was luxurious, it was downtown, very nice hotel.
Well, can you give me any further help of big hotel downtown that looks nice covers quite a few.
Boy, you're talking over a year ago.
What happened then?
Well, what did the outside look like? What color was it?
I don't recall. A light color. I think it was anyway.
And what happened then?
How tall was it?
Well, I know it was several stories.
Most hotels are, aren't they? How many stories? More or less than 20?
I don't know.
What happened then?
Isn't this the hotel you walked around and surveyed? And you still don't know whether or not it was more or less than 20 stories?
No, I do not.
Mr. Parmenter,
you want me just to proceed?
Yes.
We went to the Olympic Hotel. We were thinking about blowing up the reception area or wherever he was going to speak. We wanted to kill him.
And did you carry out your bombing plan?
No, we did not.
Why not?
We didn't have any explosives.
Were there further discussions concerning the plan to rob the armored car at the Fred Meyer store?
Yes, there were. Dan Bauer had raised an objection to it.
And what was that objection?
The objection was primarily on religious grounds, whether or not the right to rob is a means of funding the order.
The robbery was called off, is that correct?
That's correct.
Did you return to Cheney?
Yes, I did. Things were left kind of up in the air as to what direction the order would take. And as to my personal affairs, I was still having trouble with my wife.
So you dropped out of contact with the group for a while?
Yes.
December 1983. Robert J. Matthews single-handedly robs the Innis Arden branch of the Citibank in Seattle. He leaves with $25,900.
January 1984, Bruce Pierce and Gary Yarborough rob the Washington Mutual Savings Bank and they leave with $3,600.
March 1984, four order members return to the Fred Meyer store they had surveyed in November of 83. They corner George King, a guard for the Continental Armed Transport Company. They put guns to King's head and remove the money from his metal cart.
The Fred Meyer robbery nets the order $39,465.
What did Mr. Dewey tell you?
That he had participated in the carrier job at the Fred Meyer store in Seattle.
Did he show you anything?
He showed me money they'd gotten from the robbery.
How much money?
He said it was $7,000, share of the proceeds.
You had a job at Keytronics. You were working on a mold machine?
Yes.
And your rate of pay there?
$3.69 an hour.
Then you rejoined the order after Mr. Dewey showed you $7,000 that purportedly came from the Seattle robbery.
Well, among other things, yes, I wanted to get into those activities.
So you joined for philosophical reasons?
It's the same reasons I was involved in the first place.
If Mr. Dewey had told you in March of 84 that they had gone to Seattle and made about $5 apiece in that robbery, do you think you would have rejoined?
The reason I rejoined was because the order was doing something. We weren't in this for financial gain.
You didn't do this for personal gain?
No.
Did you still think that robbing people was irreligious when you rejoined the group?
I think we're getting tied up in a misunderstanding here.
Just a second.
I did not say it was irreligious.
Mr. Bauer said robbery was inappropriate on religious grounds. Isn't that what you testified to yesterday?
Yes.
And you agreed with him?
Yes.
Now, Mr. Dewey shows you $7,000 and you rejoin the order, correct?
Yes.
Do you now think that it is inappropriate to rob people on religious grounds?
No.
And what has happened in the meantime to change your mind?
We had rethought the matter. It was felt that it was necessary to gain money by some means, whether it was illegitimate or not, to fund the group, to bring our cause and our goals to fruition.
And when did you and Mr. Dewey have this discussion?
Well, the same day.
And on that day, why you finally realized that religiously it was okay to rob people?
It was thought that this robbing people was at least a minor matter when we had these ultimate higher goals.
And within 4 months, you had made about $65,000 for yourself, hadn't you?
Yes.
Now that sure beats working at Keytronics, doesn't it?
That could be a way one could take it, yes.
Thank you.
April 1984, seven order members return to Seattle and this time take separate rooms in a Motel 6. Their target is a Bond apartment store located in the Northgate shopping mall.
Using two vehicles, the order pins the armored car to the Bon Marché loading dock.
Matthews holds a sign up to the window of the armored car.
What did the sign say?
Get out or die.
The guards get out of the car. One of the guards looks familiar.
It is George King, the victim of the Fred Meyer robbery. Bruce Pierce says to King,
you know the score, George.
King sits on the sidewalk with the other guards. The money is loaded into one of the order's vehicles.
The take from the Northgate robbery is $235,000.
Did you receive a portion of that robbery loot for it?
Yes, I did.
Approximately how much?
Approximately $24,000.
And what did the others receive?
Around in that neighborhood.
The order's success emboldened them. In the coming months, they would begin to successfully eliminate traitors they felt were in their midst.
May 1984, the murder of Walter West.
And enemies who were still at large.
June 1984, the murder of Alan Berg.
Their preparations for battle became increasingly sophisticated.
September 1984, the Reliance Project is formed in which scientists are recruited to develop laser weapons for the order. Plans to poison the water systems and disrupt the power supplies of major cities are pursued as well.
Mr. Parmenter, after all the money had been counted out, was there any money left over?
Yes, there was.
And did anyone suggest what should be done with the balance?
Yes, to tie the nation's church with what was thought to be 10%.
Psalm 149, let the high praise of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand.
To who?
Pastor Butler.
Not everyone who walks on two legs is human. It is not that we don't respect non-Aryans, it's just that they don't have the same status as we do. We didn't choose it. God has said it!
The melting pot theory is a myth. A myth perpetrated by the corporations to blind your eyes as they pick your pockets. War is dedicated to the white working, the farmers, the white poor. The capitalist right wing is dead. The communist left wing never was alive. This is the white wing. We've got one war, the same war the SA fought in Germany, right here in the streets of America.
Faith and warfare are inseparable.
There's war in America, and there are two camps. One camp is in Washington, D.C., controlled by the Antichrist Jews.
Candidates, come forward.
Make no mistake about it. Their goal is the destruction of our race, our faith people, and our goal is the destruction of them. There is no middle ground.
Raise your arms and salute.
Immigration and abortion are destroying the Aryan race.
Why are you so shocked?
96%.
I pledge my allegiance.
I pledge my allegiance. 70 million abortions have been abortions of white Aryan children.
To the law ordained by my heavenly father.
To the law ordained by my heavenly father.
This is genocide.
Did you think this was a game?
To my Aryan race, which is my nation.
Have not all the living sermons, have not all the living sermons, have not all the world events told you that it is us?
It is time to make war by making love. It is time for every healthy Aryan woman to bear children. This is a woman's supreme and holy task.
I will not betray my commanders or their faith in me.
I will not betray my commanders or their faith in me.
No kinsman should raise his sword against Zog until he has planted his seed in the belly of a woman.
I will never rest until there is created on this continent a national state for my people.
They want to steal the minds of your children.
All children born Aryan and healthy are considered legitimate.
This pledge I take before God and of these my Aryan brothers.
Any allegiance is worthless. Not the intention of ways. War is senseless and useless.
Every child that an Aryan mother brings into the world is a battle waged for the existence of her people.
It is not right that matters, but victory.
One God.
Have no pity.
One God.
One nation.
Adopt a brutal attitude.
One nation.
Right is on the side of the strongest.
One race.
By warding off the Jews, I am fighting for the Lord's work.
One race.
I lay upon you the sword of truth, knighting you in brotherhood for the glory of Yahweh, our God.
We believe that hate is our law.
Greet your new comrades.
And revenge is our duty.
We are not right or left wing. We are racists. We are now officially operating an underground chapter on your campus and over 30 chapters nationwide. The next line of leadership shall be a generation of ruthless predators that shall make past Aryan leaders and warriors pale in comparison. If peaceful means fail, then the white youth of this nation shall utilize every option available to them to neutralize and quite possibly to engage in the wholesale extermination of all subhuman, non-Aryan peoples from the face of the North American continent.
My Aryan brothers, behold the glory of Yahweh, our God. As warriors for our God, we come to light the holy cross of our Aryan Savior. Behold the white fire which has raged in the hearts of our heroes. Heroes such as Jack London, Charles Lindbergh, Rudolf Hess, George Lincoln Rockwell, and Joe McCarthy. Martyrs such as Gordon Call, Adolf Hitler, and Robert J. Matthews.
There is a violence that liberates, and there is a violence that enslaves.
Do the work which is required of you in this season.
There is a violence that is moral.
Prepare for the work ahead.
There is a violence that is immoral.
Our light came from the cross.
Know that the hour of the harvest comes
and shall return to the cross.
In the right time, more than just the moon shall rise.
What you see tonight.
Hail victory!
Hail victory!
What you are experiencing tonight.
Hail victory!
Hail victory!
You will never again forget.
Hail victory!
The three people that were speaking at the end were Thomas, these were actual quotes. Most of what's in the play is actually taken from court testimony or transcriptions of actual sermons and speeches that were given by certain famous people. Thomas Robb, the Grand Dragon of the Ku Klux Klan, Tom Metzger, who's trial, I don't know, you probably discussed, he recently went to trial, and his white supremacist group has been pretty much put out of business. And
see who's the third one. Metzger, Rob, and...
Pastor Butler, Richard Butler, the Aryan Nation. Okay, so we'll just continue, because we don't have that much time. We've made significant cuts in here, so it shouldn't take as long as it did to do the whole thing.
July 1984, 12 order members gather for a morning prayer at a Motel 8 in Santa Rosa, California. They have recruited as members two men who work for the Brinks Company in San Francisco.
These men agree to provide the order with inside information on the best armored car routes to rob.
And points to an armored car bound for Ukiah, California.
As the car slows, going up a steep grade on Route 101, members of the order using two trucks force the armored car to the side of the road. Bill Soderquist holds up a side to the window of the car.
Get out or die.
With military precision, money is removed from the Brinks truck.
35 seconds.
Richard Scutari monitors police radios and shouts out the elapsed time to the other men.
The only complication is a female guard who refuses to come out of the armored car.
Randy Evans fires a shotgun blast into the rear compartment where she is hiding.
He later expresses amazement that she was not killed.
They arrive to a prearranged area, switch automobiles, and transport the money to a house in Boise, Idaho.
The take from the Ukiah robbery is $3.6 million cash.
All order members receive a six-month salary of $10,000, and participants in the robbery receive a bonus of $30,000.
Significant portions of the money are sent to Robert Miles and his mountain church in Michigan.
Glenn Miller and his white party in North Carolina.
Louis Beam, identity preacher and Texas Klan leader.
And naturally, William Pierce, director of the National Alliance and author of The Turner Diaries.
In 10 months, had carried out the most successful crime spree in United States history. My wife and I fought over what to name our son. The pressure of it became so real, so crucial, that we thought of nothing else. We viewed it as this stamp, this mark. Wear this, it's your name. And if you have a good name, then you'll be fine. It will protect you. It will remind you of our good intentions. Remember, we love you enough to have put our marriage in jeopardy to arrive at your name. Never forget that. Other things were less crucial. There were things I said to my son as he grew into manhood. You want your laundry fast? Take it to that chink on the corner. When you go by that car, don't let him try to Jew you down. I don't want you to take any shit from that man you work for. You're not his nigger. I do not view these mark on him. They were just a necessary evil of living in a hard world. My son had his name. He would be fine. But now he was putting things in his basement. He didn't shave his head and snort glue. He didn't stand on a street corner and use fear to hand out hope. He smiled when he shook my hand, and he never missed a Father's Day. Now he's putting things in his basement. He got a good job, married a lovely woman, coached Little League baseball. I did not teach him how to hate. I did not teach him to be violent. I was just realistic. I just told him the way things were. This morning I went to his house to borrow his mower. Had it in the basement all winter, Dad. Haven't brought it up yet. You'll see it down there. Now in the basement, where I had never been, were all the things my son had learned from me. There were weapons. There were explosives. There were maps outlining his white homeland. There were newspapers, the Spotlight, the Thunderbolt, the Torch, the Way, the Aryan Nations newsletter. There was a picture of Adolf Hitler. And beside it, also in a place of honor, was a picture of me. There were things I said to my son, and now he has mastered the things I only boasted of. He has the good name, and now he's putting things in his basement.
This music! We call it oi! Oi, oi, oi!
Jump cut me. Jump cut me. Oi is not punk rock! Oi is not hardcore or heavy metal! Oi is warrior music. The system tried to steal it to play in their elevators. The system tried to destroy it because it's a tyranny. Both attempts failed. Jump cut me. Don't let the left hand know. Oi is is the music of the white warrior. Our minds are clear, our fists are strong, our heads are saved for battle. Talk!
June 1987. White student union leader Craig Withrow places a phone call to his racist mentor, Tom Metzger. Withrow tells Metzger that he, quote, does not want to hate anymore, unquote. That for the first time in his life, he has loved someone, a woman named Sylvia, and that in doing, begun to feel compassion for others. Withrow resigns as the union's leader. He tells a reporter that he has plans to write a book denouncing the white racist movement and exposing many of its crimes and conspiracies.
Skinheads of America, like the dynamic skinheads of Europe, are working class Aryan youth. We believe in hard work. We believe that motherhood is the most noble position to which any white woman can aspire. We believe that only a family with a dominant male and a proud female is the way to ensure the proper reproduction of our race. 8-8, we cry. 8-8! We are at war with the system, with the traitors, with the cowards, with the faggots, with the niggers, with the mud people, with the limp-wristed queers. This battle will receive our full attention.
Despondent and fearful after denouncing racism, Withrow attempts suicide twice during the month of June. On July 4th, 1987, Withrow's former recruits enter his apartment in Sacramento. They club him with baseball bats and steal the manuscript that he has been writing.
We are the heirs to the revolution. The parasitic pacifists have leached off our land for far too long. Our future has been bargained. Our future has been sucked through the status quo and left to rot on the breadlines of the capitalist West and the headlines of the communist East. Jump cut me. A white woman panhandles to feed her baby and Bush. Sleep soundly, and push, sleep soundly. 8-8, we cry. 8-8!
August 1987, Greg Withrow leaves his Sacramento apartment. Six of his former group grab him, throw him in a pickup, and drive him to a vacant lot.
Deep in the heart of the white youth is a brutal logic. This logic will leave our enemies nowhere to run.
A 6-foot-long board is removed from the back of the truck.
Logic is the weapon of the white youth.
After being brutally beaten, Withrow is strapped to the board.
It is morally invincible.
Nails are driven through his hand.
It is ordained!
And his throat is cut open with a razor.
8-8, we cry. The 8th letter in our language, the letter H.
Withrow is left for dead in the vacant lot.
8-8, we cry. Heil Hitler!
Stumbles through the streets, unable to solicit help. After numerous white couples refuse to assist him, two men, a black and an Hispanic, come to his aid.
Don't let the left hand know. Don't let the left hand know what the white... what the white hand is doing.
The Sacramento County Sheriff has no suspects because Withrow is afraid to name his attacker.
Our music is oi,
said Withrow.
Our fists are strong.
They want me dead for the things I know.
And our heads are shaved for battle.
Mr. Parmenter, did you get an insurance policy in April of 84 because you were a member of the Order's inner circle?
No, I was not a member of the inner circle.
Well, when did you become a member?
Right after the Ukiah robbery.
But you were a member of the inner circle in April, were you not? That's one of the reasons you got the insurance.
Objection, Your Honor. The witness never said that.
You can answer the question now.
Can I explain it, Your Honor?
Sure.
I did not say I was a member of the inner circle. What I said was that members of the inner circle had gotten life insurance. I never included myself in it.
Let me read this to you. Who was involved in getting life insurance policies? Answered by you, Mr. Dewey, Mr. Pierce, Mr. Matthews, and myself.
Objection, Your Honor.
That doesn't finish the question.
That's not responsive to...
Sit down.
Question. Those were members of the inner circle, weren't they? Answer by you, yes, they were.
Well, that was obviously a slip-up because...
Do you want to retract the answer you gave yesterday under oath?
When I responded to that question, I was not...
I'm sorry, I don't mean to be rude, but the question before you is, do you want to retract the answer you gave yesterday under oath?
I would like to clarify it.
Go ahead, clarify it.
I did not mean to include myself.
Even though you said yourself.
I did say that, yeah.
You were a leader of the order, is that correct?
I had leadership responsibilities, yes.
Parmenter, you've had multiple opportunities to go over your story before coming here, is this correct?
I wouldn't call it a story, I would call it testimony.
Early on in your testimony, you characterized yourself as unstable. Is that true?
That's correct.
Would you say that still pertains to you?
No, I would not.
Since when?
I would say since the time of my arrest.
You said you've read the Bible several times since your dramatic prison conversion.
Objection!
Excuse me. Since your conversion in jail, is that true?
That's correct.
Cover to cover?
Most of it.
And now you've changed your beliefs, correct?
Well, I no longer...
Is that correct? You've changed your beliefs?
Yes.
Much of the testimony you've given here is based upon what Bob Matthews told you. Isn't that correct?
Well, some of it is, yes.
And Mr. Matthews not going to be able to testify, is he?
That's correct.
And indeed, you were candid enough to tell the jury yesterday that it would be common sense for one to say that he changed his beliefs in order to affect sentencing, correct?
And we're going to have to rely upon you as to the accuracy as to what you say Mr. Matthews said, isn't that right?
Isn't that what you said yesterday?
Well, yes, it is.
Mr. Parmenter, you suggested earlier that one of the reasons Mr. West had been killed because he had been drinking and beating his wife.
That's what I heard, yes.
Did that make you feel nervous or concerned at all about your personal safety?
No, it did not.
Even though you yourself have testified that you also were a heavy drinker.
Well, that's true.
And even though you have had a lot of strange situations with your wife, isn't that true?
And, Your Honor, this is a very improper question on the part of Mr. Heller.
I will rephrase it if you like.
He's rephrasing the question.
Would it surprise you to know that members of the order were under the impression that you regularly beat?
That would definitely surprise me, yes.
Okay, then.
Is he now asking when he stopped beating his wife?
That was my next question.
Objection, Your Honor. I object to the next question.
Thank you. Next question, please. Since you joined the order, you continually lied to people, sometimes under oath, pretending to be a person you were not, didn't you?
Yes, we all did.
And you were believed, were you not?
Most of the time we were, yes.
Well, you were. I'm talking about you.
I had different aliases, yes.
One of the provisions of your plea required you to take a polygraph.
Yes.
A lie detector, correct?
Yes.
And you did take a polygraph, did you not? And you failed that polygraph and were required to take another one, weren't you?
Yes, I was.
What is an Aryan?
White person.
Any old white person?
Yeah.
What about me? Do I look white
Objection.
To you?
Objection.
Next question.
You've admitted that you'll lie to protect your own self-interest. Isn't this correct?
Was it your hope at some point that you could just eliminate all Jews?
That was part of the doctrine, yes.
Isn't that correct?
There were different situations.
Yes or no, Mr. Parmenter?
Would you have been willing to kill me because I'm Jewish?
Objection, Your Honor.
Sustained.
Yes or no, Mr. Parmenter?
You were a convincing liar, correct?
I would say it didn't take too much convincing because I had ID and there was no one really checking on it. When you sign into a motel, they don't give you the third degree.
Were you a member of the inner circle?
Your Honor, I think this is probably the 50th time I've heard that question.
60th.
I've really racked them up.
You had to be a pretty convincing liar to get the ID, didn't you?
You had to fill out a form.
Would it be fair to say that you have exhibited during the times you have been drunk and sober a Jekyll and Hyde personality?
There were times when I was drinking violent.
Mm-hmm. I take it you're in your Dr. Jekyll role with us here today.
Objection!
It's stricken. Let's get on with it, Mr. Halpern.
Last question.
I'm going to have to rely on you, even though you've admitted that you'll betray your oath and betray your friends. Isn't that correct?
Under the situation, that's correct.
With Mr. Matthews dead, aren't you the most important living member of the order?
Oh, that's absurd.
No further questions.
What should an order member carry at all times?
An order member should carry $500 cash mines.
What numbers should he know?
He should know the bear trap number. He should only call this number if his cover is blown and he's arrested.
What other numbers should he know?
He should know the message center number. He should only leave messages for the members between 4 and 5 p.m. Mountain Standard Time.
Who will relay the messages?
Carlos.
Who's Carlos?
Robert Matthews.
Where did his name come from?
From Carlos Sanchez, the man who disposed of the Jew athletes at the Munich Olympics.
What are phones to an order member?
Phones are poisonous. They are monitored by Zog.
Should a member give out his phone number?
Only in code, one digit above the actual number.
Number 537-2549.
It is 426-1438.
What words should not be used on the phone?
Right wing, guns, feds, money, dollars, agents, and warrants.
Why?
Zog is listening. There is always a more discreet word that can be substituted.
How does an order member confuse Zog?
He makes two misleading phone calls each week to various parts of the country, then hangs up. Zog will have to use extreme manpower to follow these false leads.
Personality conflicts.
All personality conflicts must come to an immediate end. If you do not have something to say about a comrade, do not say anything at all.
Alcohol.
The overconsumption of alcohol is a security risk. It lowers morale and will not be tolerated.
If Zog launches an offensive against the order, what should be done?
Inflict maximum damage. Go for the brain, not the foot. Go for the throat, not the hand. An individual Aryan warrior is capable of inflicting great harm to Zog.
How does a man become an Aryan warrior?
By earning one full point under the point system.
How are points earned?
Assassinating members of Congress, 1/5 of a point. Judges, 1/6. FBI agents and federal marshals, 10th of a point. Journalists and local politicians, 1/12.
Is there a way to earn a full point?
Yes, by assassinating the President of the United States.
What is the ultimate end of politics?
The ultimate end of politics is war.
And whose country is this?
This is God's country, which he has given to me.
Mr. Rader, Why did you join CSA, the Covenant Sword and Arm of the Lord?
Like the idea of not being around smoking, drinking, and cussing.
Randall Rader, one of the government's original 23 defendants who agreed to testify against his former order members.
That's the sole reason you joined?
Yeah, I'd say so.
As a survivalist instructor, Rader once killed and ate his own dog to make a point.
It had nothing to do with religion.
Well, yes.
I mean, you could be an atheist and not smoke, drink, or cuss.
Well, true, I enjoy the Christian atmosphere.
Well, then what possessed you to participate in arson in 1979?
I was guided by Mr. Ellison during that.
And were you assured by Mr. Ellison that that was a Christian act?
Yes, sir.
And it was a deliberate burning down of a building to cheat an insurance company, wasn't it?
Yes, sir.
Well, did you question as to how that particular act managed to fit into the teachings of Christ?
Not at that time.
I see. If Mr. Ellison assured you that it was Christian, why, that was good enough for you.
Yes, sir.
Rader left the CSA compound in Arkansas in May of 1984 after being recruited by Matthews to come to northern Idaho.
You had value in terms of being able to teach people about military groups and shooting guns and all that sort of thing, is that right?
Yes.
Isn't it true that when you were recruited to join, you were considered the foremost civilian person in this country on the subject of paramilitary training?
Some people considered me that, yes.
You did have a certain amount of power, did you not?
I was given a group to work with, yes.
And you wanted the power, didn't you?
I enjoyed it to a certain extent, yes.
Rader constructed what was called a silhouette city for the order. Shed wood and cardboard symbolized an urban environment. Photos of the group's enemies were nailed to the shacks and used as targets.
What is the maximum number of people that you had at your training camp in Idaho?
18, I think, something like that.
And among the types of warfare and training was guerrilla warfare?
Yes, sir.
Against whom?
We did not train against anyone, sir.
Well, who were you proposing to utilize this against?
Who was I proposing?
Yes.
Communists.
Which communists?
Russians.
Any particular date in mind? You didn't have any particular target in mind except the invading Russian army whenever they get here?
Yes, sir.
Did you think that as a result of the training that you were providing people that they were going to commit crimes?
I thought it was a possibility, yes.
You thought it was likely to happen, didn't you?
Yes.
There was no way you could hide from that fact, could you?
What do you mean, hide from it?
There was no way that you could pretend that all this was just innocent playing in the woods, was there?
No.
You knew, or you had good reason to think, that what you were teaching might be used in such a way that either they or innocent people might get killed.
Yes.
And yet you went right ahead and taught them, right?
Yes.
Now about this MAC-10 that you had originally purchased in your name, it would fire how many rounds a minute?
About 900.
It would discharge 30 shots in approximately how much time?
About 2 seconds if you stayed on the trigger.
It would empty them in a hurry, right?
Yes.
When did you sell that?
Around May 14th.
Now, at that time, you wanted the serial numbers removed?
Yes, sir.
Why?
Because it was a fully automatic weapon.
Well, if nothing is going to be done, what difference does it make?
If it was found, it could be traced back to me, and I would have to account for why it was a fully automatic weapon.
Did you know what was going to be done with the weapon?
No, sir.
This isn't a weapon that you go hunting birds with, was it?
No.
And you sure wouldn't go hunting squirrels with it, would you?
No.
Because you just... Well, your target would just disappear on you, right?
Yes.
Now, when did you say you saw Mr. Matthews and a few other people drive off to Denver?
That was around the 14th or 15th of June.
And did you see them taking your weapon with them?
No, sir.
Did they were taking it?
I was told they were.
I mean, the basic value of this type of weapon is that it will shoot out a lot of bullets in a minimal space of time covering a wide area.
That's one of the values.
Now, at that time, you knew there was an assassination step, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
And you knew they were taking your weapon with them to Denver, right?
Yes, sir.
What you do with the thing is you shoot people with it, right?
Yes.
Well, didn't you know they were going to Denver to kill somebody?
No, sir.
You hadn't the faint idea. Is that your testimony?
Yes, sir.
And you saw them come back, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
And they had your weapon with them, didn't they?
I didn't see it.
When did they come back?
Around the 21st or 22nd of June.
And is that when you first found out that Mr. Berg had been eliminated?
Yes, sir.
One more thing. How do you think God feels about your activities?
I think he's pretty,
No further questions.
That's all.
There exists only one large territory in the North America that is as yet white and uncrowded, the five Northwest states.
Washington, Oregon.
Idaho.
Montana and Wyoming.
Our forefathers created the greatest of cultures in lands which offered far less.
In the last decade, tens of thousands of white families have already fled from the mongrelized areas of the Northwest.
January 1986. Legislators in 48 states receive a book called Amendment to the Constitution, Averting the Decline and Fall of America. The book outlines what is called the Pace Amendment to the Constitution.
No person shall be a citizen of the United States unless he is a non-Hispanic white of the European race.
In whom there is no ascertainable trace of Negro blood.
No more than 1/8 Mongolian, Asian, Asian Minor, Middle Eastern, Semitic, Near Eastern, American Indian, Malaysian, or other non-European or non-white blood.
And providing that he is, in appearance, indistinguishable from other Americans whose ancestral homes is the British Isles or Northwestern Europe.
Only citizens shall have the privilege to reside permanently in the United States.
The Indians have their reservations. We want our land.
James O. Pace is the pseudonym for the amendment's author, whose true identity is unknown.
We don't want to be greedy.
Five states are enough.
Officials at Harvard Law School, however, have verified that the author was a member of the board of editors at their International Law Journal.
It's a truly Christian gesture.
It will be a new Garden of Eden.
We take over, we won't ask anybody to leave. But if I was a Jew in Seattle, I'd move to Israel.
State name for the record and spell your last name.
My name is Judith Berg.
Mrs. Berg.
B-E-R-G.
Excuse me. Mrs. Berg, you were married to Alan Berg for 20 years?
Yes.
From when to when?
From 1958 to 1978.
Did you have dinner with him on the last day of his life, June 18th, 1984?
I did.
Your marriage ended in 1978, is that correct?
Yes.
And after your marriage ended, did you and Alan Berg remain close friends?
We did.
And from time to time, would you call in and participate in his program?
Yes. We'd set up an issue where there were situations going on in the country, as in Johnny Carson's wife wanted $20,000 for phone calls. And Alan would, he always had settlements and so forth, and I would call in, and he would do bits on that.
Was this pre-arranged?
Yes.
Did you also have one show in which you had a so-called dispute with Mr. Berg over custody of the dog?
Yes, custody of the dog.
Mr. Parmenter, what did Mr. Matthew respect to the murder?
Well, he told me about the surveillance, that it was done prior to the murder by an old lady who was a relative of Zilla.
And who is Zilla?
Zilla was his girlfriend.
What's her last name?
Craig.
And what do you mean by surveillance?
This person had gone and done surveillance of his home, his place of employment, and his routine.
Do you recall a conversation you had with a visitor at KOA?
Yes, I do.
Can you describe the person that you met?
Woman, about 5'6", middle-aged, shoulder-length hair, dark with gray.
What did she say to you?
She said she was a student from Wyoming. Information, she asked who was on the air. I gave her our lineup.
Who was on the air at the time the woman was there?
Alan Berg.
Did she ask you any further questions?
Yes, she asked if everybody had to be buzzed in and out, and I said yes.
Did she ask to meet anyone?
She asked if she could meet Alan Berg. I said no.
Why?
Because our policy is no one meets or even takes tours of the studio without being cleared through the program director. She thanked me. I said, you're welcome. I went back into the studios, got my keys and my coat so I could go to lunch.
When you came out to go to lunch, did you see anything?
Yes, I did.
What did you see?
Someone was taking pictures.
Who?
The woman that I'd talked to in the lobby.
June 18th, 1984. Armed with the intelligence provided by Gene Craig, order members Matthews, Pierce, Lane, and Richard Scutari assemble in Denver.
On June 18th, which is a Monday, correct?
Right.
Where did you and Mr. Berg have dinner?
A restaurant called the Jefferson 440. I met Alan. I had my parents' car, and I met him at the Cherry Creek Shopping Center. About 10 minutes east of Denver. I met him there, and we went in his car.
Can you recall what time you went to dinner?
Between 6:30 and 7.
Okay, after you had finished dinner, what did you and Mr. Berg do?
We were going home to feed the dog and call his mother.
And then we were going to visit a friend of ours.
We decided Alan better not because he had to get ready for the next day's show.
And at this point, are you still in Mr. Berg's car after dinner?
He said...
Listen, we'll call Mother tomorrow, that way we won't get Fred all excited and jumping around.
Who's Fred?
The dog.
Did you actually stop and buy dog food?
We did.
Convenience store on 6th Avenue, and then he took me to my car.
And on the way to your car, you drove past Mr. Berg's house?
Right.
And at one point, you were actually thinking of going in there yourself?
Yes.
And when you drove past Mr. Berg's house, Did you notice anything unusual?
I did not notice anything unusual.
How long did it take you to Kid Creek Shopping Center?
About 10 minutes.
And did you pick up your car there?
I did.
And where did you go?
I went to a friend of ours, Bobby Cook.
And where was Mr. Bird going when he left you?
He was going to prepare for the next day's show, and then I was going to go and call him and make sure that I got there all right.
Now, how long of a drive from the shopping center back to Mr. Berg's house?
About 10 minutes.
And how long of a drive from the shopping center to Bobby's house where you were going?
20 to 25 minutes.
So if he went straight home, yeah, he would have gotten there before you got where you were going.
Absolutely.
But to Bobby's?
I did.
And you had made arrangements to call Mr. Berg?
Yes. I went in and I said, I've got to call Alan right away because he's concerned that I would get here all right. So I called, and the tape was on.
What tape are you referring to?
Alan had an answering machine.
So nobody answered the phone?
Well, at first I thought maybe he'd walked Fred, and I kept calling and calling, but he never answered.
October 1984. Several events traveling of the order.
A submachine gun, which Robert Matthews mistakenly left behind at the site of the Ukiah robbery, is traced to its owner, Andrew Barnhill, a known order member.
The FBI suspects for the first time that numerous crimes are the work of one group.
Thomas Martinez is arrested in Philadelphia for passing counterfeit money. Still a trusted friend of Robert Matthews, Martinez agrees to be an FBI informant, enabling the FBI to track the movements of the order.
October 18, 1984. Federal agents arrive at Gary Yarborough's house in Sandpoint, Idaho. Yarborough opens fire on the agents and flees.
A search of Yarborough's house uncovers a cache of weapons, explosives, and documents, revealing the command structure of the order.
Also discovered is a shrine to Adolf Hitler.
November 24th, 1984. Using Matthews as a decoy, the FBI tracks Yarborough and Matthews to a motel in Portland, Oregon. Yarborough is captured. Matthews escapes after a shootout with FBI agents.
After running for 2 blocks, I decided to quit being the hunted and become the hunter. I drew my gun and waited behind a concrete wall for the agent to draw near. When I aimed my gun at the head of the closest agent, I saw the handsome face of a young white man, and I lowered my aim to his knee and foot. Had I not done so, I could have killed both agents and still had left the use of my hand, which is now mangled beyond repair. That is the last time I will ever give quarter.
Following word of the shootout in Portland, order members flee to various parts of the country.
Many take refuge at the Arkansas compound of the Covenant Sword and Arm of the Lord.
Matthews and 4 others flee to Whidbey Island near.
A declaration of war is drafted and signed.
We hereby declare ourselves to be a free and sovereign people. Let friend and foe alike be made aware.
We declare ourselves to be in a full and unrelenting state of war with those forces seeking and promoting the destruction of our faith and our race.
For blood, soil, and honor. For the future of our children.
For our King, Jesus Christ.
We commit ourselves to battle.
One critical piece of evidence is found at Gary Yarborough's house in Sandpoint.
Never forget.
It is a fully automatic MAC-10 submachine gun.
As long as one member of the Order is alive, the Order lives.
The gun that 5 months earlier had murdered Alan Berg.
At first I thought maybe he'd walked Fred, and I just kept calling and calling, but he never answered. In between calling him, I called my mother, just to tell her, you know, where I was, and that I wouldn't be home late. Then later, since she knew where I was, my mother called, and she asked Bobby what I was doing. He said, we were just sitting there, I was trying to get a hold of Alan. She said, is the television on? And Bobby said, no. And she told her what had happened.
June 18, 1984, 9:20 p.m. Bruce Peartz waits in the bushes which surround the driveway of Alan Berg's home at 1445 Adams Street in Denver. David Lane waits nearby in a getaway car. Also in the vicinity, in separate vehicles, are Robert J. Matthews and Richard Scutari. Berg pulls into the driveway in his black Volkswagen. He lights a cigarette. He grabs a small bag of dog food he has purchased, and he begins to step out of the car.
It was a loud neighborhood. Loud is probably one of the most striking things about that neighborhood.
Were you at home that evening?
Yes.
And do you remember hearing any unusual sound?
I thought it sounded like a machine gun, but it was too quiet. Maybe a whole package of firecrackers going.
Mr. Parmenter, did you discuss with Mr. Pierce the killing of Alan Berg?
Well, yes, I did.
And what did Mr. Pierce say to you?
He told me Berg fell as if the carpet had been pulled out from under him.
Now, Officer Phelan, when you got there, was the body and the blood which is depicted in that photograph different in any way?
I recall that the right leg of the victim was still inside the vehicle. Also, this picture shows the blood a little further advanced down the driveway than when I first arrived. And when I arrived on the scene, there was a burning cigarette to the right of the victim's body.
Detective Kerber, can you identify what is contained in Exhibit 3037?
Yes, these are .345 caliber bullets I recovered.
And when did you first notice them?
While we were running the video, I was taking photographs, and as they turned the body, they fell out of the body.
They fell out of the body?
Yes.
Dr. Agura, are you the coroner's pathologist for the city of Denver?
Yes.
Dr. Agura, from your examination, is it possible to say conclusively exactly how many bullets hit Alan Berg that night?
No, I am not positive how many, but at the time of the examination, when I had finished, I felt that a minimum of 12 bullets had to have entered him.
Mr. Martin, the time that you were cutting counterfeit bills, did you have a conversation with David Lane about the murder of Alan Berg?
Yes, we were sitting at the table cutting money. I asked him, and he laughed, and he said, "Hell, I drove the getaway car." And I was in shock, and I said, "You gotta be kidding me." He said, "No, we watched that juke-kike while he was eating dinner. Our intelligence was gathered real well, and we waited for him for 6 or 7 hours in that area."
Were the words juke-kike his words?
Yes.
And what was his tone of voice when he told you about his participation in this incident?
Just natural.
Why turn here? There are 34 other radio stations in this town. Why turn here if I make you so damn miserable? You have no credibility. You dig what I do when you have a need. Unfortunately, you have no sense of humor. And that's why you can't ever enjoy the show. And that's why you are a loser, as are all people that have no sense of humor. And you are categorically one of them.
Mrs. Berg, you were never successful in reaching Alan.
No.
You had stated that you were going to discuss the next day's show. Do you recall the topic of the next day's show?
Yes. The next day's show would have been gold.
No further questions.
December 16th, 1985. After 3.5 months of testimony, the government's case against the order goes to the jury in Seattle.
Now, in working on this case this summer, it occurred to me that I might be giving an argument someday, and I was thinking about something I had read. I simply want to borrow the words of the speaker because he described it far better than I can.
The jury of 8 white women and 4 white men deliberate for 2 weeks.
The speaker was a young man by the name of Peter Hill, who was one of the hostages on the TW that was hijacked out of Athens and brought to Beirut. This individual, when he got out, made this statement describing the people that had captured him. They were a band of thieves, thugs, and murderers who justified their deeds with vows of religious fervor.
December 30th, 1985, a verdict is reached.
I read that, and I said to myself, that's the defendants in our case. And I submit to you that's exactly what they are, and they should be found guilty as charged. Thank you.
All 10 defendants are found guilty of racketeering and of conspiracy to racketeer. Sentencing takes place on February 6, 1986.
Mr. Lane, is there anything you'd like to say before a sentence is passed?
Pierce and Dewey are sentenced to 100 years in prison. Yarbrough and Kemp, 60 years.
For a time, I pondered whether I was going to make any statement. However, I'll probably never have my voice heard outside of the cage again, and I'm going to take this opportunity to say a few things.
Lane, Barnhill, Craig, Silva, Evans, and McBrearty get 40 years each.
I do not swear all members of the order. I most assuredly am the voice of my dearest friend, the most incredible man I have ever known, the finest man yet produced on this continent, Robert J. Matthews.
December 7th, 1984. Federal agents and local law enforcement personnel surround 3 houses on Whidbey Island near Seattle. Shipping lanes on Puget Sound are closed, and air traffic is diverted around the area.
The houses are suspected to be the hideout of several order members, including Robert J. Matthews.
They are also rumored to be stockpiled with huge quantities of arms, ammunition, and explosives.
Man stands alone against something as large as the American branch of the world government. He has to question his own rightness and sanity, and I've done so.
As the siege of Whidbey Island continues, a Navy helicopter flies over the houses demanding that the fugitives surrender.
I've given all that I have and all that I am to waken my people from their sleep of death. And if my efforts were futile, then mankind's dreams to the stars are over.
The first person to emerge from one of the houses is Randy Dewey.
Dewey runs toward the FBI, brandishing a machine gun. He stops when he sees them and says,
"A white man."
At which point he surrenders.
Mr. Yarbrough.
The question is not whether we are guilty, but whether the indictment is legal.
After 24 hours, 3 other order members surrender on Whidbey Island. Matthews is still believed to be inside one of the houses.
This was a political trial, and these men are no more criminals than their forefathers that participated in the Boston Tea Party for the very same cause. Unjust laws, unjust taxes, freedom of speech, freedom of religion.
History.
I won't plead to this court for leniency. I will make my pleas to my God and Father.
History will be my true judge.
You have no power over me except what comes from him.
December 8th, 11 a.m. Negotiations break down between Matthews and the FBI.
Mr. Pierce.
The FBI begins firing tear gas canisters into the house.
I'm not going to waste my time or yours and cry to you, nor beg to this court for mercy. Your mind's made up. I want you to know that the power given you is from Almighty God and else. And the sentence you impose on me is according to his will on my life.
3:30 p.m. A single gunshot is fired inside the house.
Thinking Matthews may have taken his own life, a SWAT team enters the house.
Let it flow. Let people choose to believe what they want.
I will miss my family dearly.
Challenge it in open forum.
Matthews is hiding in the second story of the house.
I'm sorry for the pain and grief I've caused my dear wife, my family.
I'd like to be able to hug my children.
Matthews opens fire on the agents.
I don't wish for anyone to go through what I've just been through.
Single-handedly drives the agents from the house.
But there will be many more to follow.
I think short of inciting a riot, let people say what they want to say.
Blood will flow and it grieves me.
Following the Seattle verdict, the Denver district attorney considers filing murder charges in the Berg case.
As ugly as they may be.
Unable to get a confession from any other participants and fearful of the trial's costs, the Denver authorities dropped the case.
Now, people, that to me is true freedom of speech.
The members of the order are indicted instead for violating Alan Bull rights by killing him.
Not long ago, a little 5-year-old white girl who calls me Uncle David asked me, Uncle David, why are you in jail? And I answered, because I love you. And because some bad people don't want little white children to live on Earth anymore.
I'd like to bring honor to my family.
As ye have judged, so shall ye be judged.
This tyranny leaves men only two choices.
My brother kinsman.
I am free of your blood.
Life with dishonor.
And glory to God.
Or death with honor.
It's on your own hand.
I have no choice! The government seems determined to force the issue. I must stand up like a white man and do battle.
6:11 p.m.
The day will come when you will pay for betraying your race.
Fearing Matthews may try to escape under cover of darkness.
The FBI orders a helicopter to drop illumination flares on the Whidbey Island house.
We hold you responsible for these things.
The flares burn through the ceiling and fall into the house.
For every white child terrorized in a racially mixed school.
The flares ignite the explosives within the house.
White person murdered in one of our urban jungles.
Matthews' arsenal explodes around him.
For every white woman raped by one of the arrogant equals roaming our streets.
The house is consumed in flames.
But each day the list grows longer. But the day will come when the whole score will be settled and you will pay for every one of these debts in full.
Matthews is incinerated.
What you see tonight.
Many have disagreed with our methods.
At least we were not afraid to take on the beast.
What you are experiencing tonight.
We have given you 10 martyrs.
It's dawning for white people in this country.
You will never again forget.
Whether you were an instigator of the treason or whether you simply went along for the ride will make little difference to us.
It is time to follow our example.
The order has shown you the way.
When the day comes, we will not ask you whether you swung to the right or whether you swung to the left.
Succeed where we have fail.
We will simply swing you from the neck.
Hail victory!
Hail victory!
2 months before his death on Whidbey Island, Robert Matthews attends to his mistress, Zilla Craig, as their child in a secluded farmhouse near Laramie, Wyoming.
I was a very unstable individual. I was dissatisfied with my life and my circumstances. I was looking for something to give me self-worth, some identity. And the movement itself gave that to me. It gave me something to blame my situation on.
April 7th, 1988, Fort Smith, Arkansas. The verdict is reached in the trial of 13 leading whites charged with conspiring to overthrow the government and establish a white homeland in the Northwest.
The change in my views since my arrest took time. It didn't happen overnight.
The Fort Smith defendants, including Richard Butler, Robert Miles, Louis Beam, and 5 members of the order, are found not guilty.
I was given opportunities to read the Bible in its entirety.
Everything has to have its time and its season.
And it was at that time that I discovered that the identity doctrine was a false doctrine.
Thomas Robb, national chaplain of the Ku Klux Klan, asked
about the Fort Smith verdict.
Know that the hour of the harvest comes.
Rob says the government was going to send a message to the movement.
In the right time,
the movement sent a message to the government.
More than just the moon shall rise.
December 1988, on the fourth anniversary of his death, the crowd of skinheads and white supremacists gather on Whidbey Island. They demand that the island be renamed Robert J. Matthews Memorial Park.
Things fall apart, and the center cannot hold.
For the first time in my life, I am at peace with myself.
Mirror is loosened upon the world.
And what I am here for is to right a terrible wrong.
And everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned.
I consider this a real tragedy in my life.
Never forget.
And I'm just trying to correct that.
As long as one member of the order is alive.
The best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity.
The order lives.
And to the republic for which it stands, one Aryan nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Like working on it or anything.
Or maybe, you know, you just like to talk a little. Let's turn on the light. It's dark out here.
Good job, Chris. Yeah.
How did you change in knowing something about the Holocaust or what transpired? What movement has there been for you since doing the play, this play is what I'm asking of just about all of you.
How did it affect you?
Yeah.
Well, I can just say that every time I read the newspaper, any kind of racist article just jumps out at me like it never had before. I'm very aware of it now. Just much more than I ever have been. It profoundly changed that. I wasn't really thinking about it, you know, and now I am. Anybody else?
Many of you will be happy to know that as a theater arts major, it actually made me change a lot of my curriculum and take a lot more social classes and learn a lot more about the issue.
I'd say awareness of it. That's
a good question.
Did you, by any chance, shave your head
No, tell him.
I shaved my head originally for the show, but just recently they had a competition on campus, what would you do for a Macintosh computer? And so I said I'd shave my head and paint an apple on it, and there was three finalists. I was one of the finalists. They had a random drawing out of the three, and I won the computer.
And it was just in time for this reading. Yeah. So. Yeah. Over here.
That's the correct.
Yes, sir.
That was really kind of blood-curdling.
Yeah.
And what I was wondering is what sorts of difficulties you guys went through as you were working on, whether you had to do anything in particular, you know, therapy sessions individually or as a group or something like that, to be able to pull it together and to keep performing it. Because,
disgusting stuff. We didn't do any formal, I don't know of people here that did any sort of formal professional sessions just directly related to this, but one of the things we found out really early in the process was that we couldn't leave rehearsals right after doing this play without stopping and kind of checking in with each other and talking about it. We had we had a lot of sessions at the beginnings and ends of rehearsals where we just came together and talked about things that were coming up for us in our everyday lives and sort of penetrating and affecting the actors. And I know Randy, one of the young men that left, really went through quite a large depression because he played the skinhead, that really violent skinhead part, and it was really hard for him. He found that it was just kind of literally making him sick to his stomach. So we did more like supporting each other.
In the first couple of weeks, it seemed like we hardly did anything on the show. All we did was talk about stuff. You know, it's like,
long discussions.
Yeah. It was like wasting our time. We're not getting to it.
But it wasn't.
But it wasn't, yeah.
And me personally, I went through this thing where I had a hard time taking them seriously. Where it was like there was a part of me that just kept like saying, this is not like a mass movement. This is just like six or seven thugs that got together up in the Northwest. You know what I mean? I mean, it's just, you know, that it wasn't, these guys were gangsters. That they weren't necessarily like truly racist. That they were gangsters that had picked a targeted group. I had a hard time like taking it seriously. There were like even rehearsals where we were trying to like do this in a very serious way where I found myself like laughing in the rehearsals, like it's kind of like a very like nervous energy that was coming out, but that was just a phase that you know kind of settled down and like started taking it seriously after that. We did do these like ritualistic things at times at the beginning of a rehearsal where we would put some like kind of tribal drumming music on and just like try to get into this frame of mind where you could go out and do whatever you would have to do to someone that wasn't part of your own elite, you know, to get into like a very savage, primitive kind of thing. And then we'd try to do like an opposite kind of exorcism kind of ceremony at the end of the rehearsal to be able to, you know, drive the freeways of peace.
Yes. Are the people who are in jail, are they still like writing, publishing,
yes,
anything like that,
yeah,
still propagating their beliefs?
I'll tell you a very weird story. I mean, this isn't one of them that's actually in jail, but a few months after this show closed, in fact, it was almost a month after the show closed, I had to go to Fort Wayne, Indiana for something. And the first night I was there, I checked into my motel, and I was really tired, and I turned on the television. There was some local talk show going on. And Zilla Craig, the girlfriend of Robert Matthews, another neo-Nazi woman, Judith Berg, and the man that wrote The Secret Brotherhood were all on this talk show. And I mean, it was all sort of still happening. It was like I couldn't get away from it. You know, so I think isn't...
And Metzger was on trial when we did the play. Like,
but one of the defendants is still publishing in some of the publications. And I can't remember which one is the blonde guy. What was his name? Not Martinez,
David
the other
David.
One. He's still writing because in one of the newspapers that was delivered here on this campus in the fall, there was an article by this guy from jail. So, yeah.
You know, the reason I took the show was because of the prison aspect. And for the last 20 years, I'm a Jew, and I lost quite a few members in the concentration camps. And for the last 20 years, I've been fairly involved with these people since I was about 21. And I guess my point, the reason I took it was because I think that society kind of overlooks what it's doing. And like in California, it's important, like San Quentin, Soledad, Folsom Prison, they have gangs like the Aryan Brotherhood, which we don't even pay attention to when somebody's locked up. But in those prisons, in order for you to survive if you're white, unless you stay alone, you have to join one of these organizations, and they push all this stuff. I've been at meetings where in prisons where they have talked about killing this nigger, or they're going to rape this queer, or do this, or do that. And their extension goes way beyond the prison. If someone wants you killed outside of the prison, you're dead. There's no way you're going to miss it, because they'll find you. You know, and they are at the top of the gang. It's the Aryan Brotherhood, and then it's the Nostra Familia, the Mafia gang, the Mexican Mafia gangs, and then underneath that is the Black gangs. And they war with each other, but the primary protagonist there is the Aryan Brotherhood. And you can always tell someone is from the Aryan Brotherhood simply by looking for lightning bolts on their throat or their hands. If they have a tear by their eye, it means they've killed somebody in the name of their race. If they have two or three tears, I was in a group the other night, a man had four tears next to his eyes, it means he killed four men you know, and I heard how he did it. And like, we don't like to look at this stuff. I talked about it a lot on stage. We don't like to look at this. It starts right from juvenile hall, and it moves right up to the jails, and it moves right into the prisons, and we keep putting people back into those prisons and forced into those situations. We don't come up with answers. And the prison okays this. The prison, I was at a meeting in a prison in Tehachapi where there was a guard there watching while they were talking about killing this nigger or this, that. And the prison wants that to happen because as long as the people are infighting with each other, they don't turn on the guards. And there are no guns in the prison itself. They're on the rack up above. So they can kill anybody they want, and they do it on a daily basis, you know, but we don't do that. And they publish papers, they publish prison papers, they have Aryan Brotherhood papers that they publish, and it comes all the way down to here. You know, there's a chapter in Petaluma, there's a chapter in Santa Rosa. It's all over, and we don't look at it. You know, we're not concerned about them.
I have a question. How did the man with the name Martinez get in the group?
Actually, there was a funny story about him. He was really in denial about his background, and so was Robert Matthews. Actually, some of the information that we read about Robert Matthews led us to believe that he was actually partially a Latino, and he had completely shunned that whole part of his heritage and taken on, you know, kind of overcompensated by taking on this this white supremacist attitude. And Martinez, you know, I don't know whether he was like that too. I can't remember. Do you remember?
I think he was European, Spanish, or Castilian.
Oh, right.
I don't think he was. I'm not sure.
Question.
Yeah, I have some criticism about productions such as this, well, this one in particular. Whereas I don't have any grievance with the depiction of the Order or other groups, Aryan Nations or War, Metzger's outfit. The problem I have is that along with these groups, a lot of what could be called arch conservative right-wing groups are implicated as being analogous, and that they also are, that their agenda includes direct action of violence against minorities, and that is really not the case. And I think that it is unfair to them to slander them, even though you may not agree with them. It is a malicious slander to include a group like the John Birchers, who, you know, maybe you don't agree with them, but they do not espouse a violent overthrow of this government or direct action against minorities or anything like that.
Are you referring to the litany of names? Because the only time I can think that these groups are all brought up in one pile is when their names are just being read off one
as,
right after the other.
As being fosterers and disseminators of hate literature or literature that espouses this type of hateful ideology.
I think the implication at that time is that the orders get money from these different groups, any right-wing group that would send them money. It's like, send us money. And that's what the litany is about. And as I remember, that's the implication of that particular passage.
Yeah.
It's not saying that they are doing that. It's
no,
just saying that this is what they were looking for money. So if they were giving them money, that's...
There's one quote that I thought I took down as verbatim, saying, the Birchers are the same as the Klan. That's exactly in there, and I think that that's unjust. And anybody who has...
Is that what Berg says?
Yeah.
Well, that's a direct quote from Alan Berg, not the playwright. Alan Berg says a lot of things in the play that are taken directly off his radio show. That was his opinion. A lot of people disagree with Alan Berg's opinion, and a lot of the things that he says, you know, even in this play, there are plenty of people that would probably take issue with it sitting right here in this room. He was a person that a lot of times said things over the air just to make people mad, you know. And in fact, didn't you say one time you said something on the air? It was completely in direct conflict with his beliefs, just to kind of...
He plays devil's advocate a lot, and these are transcripts right from the radio show. It wasn't the author's. The author didn't change it at all. He just took it right off the air.
But when it goes out unchallenged like that, I think people who aren't familiar with these fringe rightist groups will, the next time they hear the name, they'll right away associate and think that they know something as fact, which was actually...
So you would prefer that the author censor the real text?
Well, what is the bottom line of the John Birch story?
What is the bottom line? It's an arch-conservative Republican, you know. Anybody who's interested can go to their bookstore on 4th Street, and I don't think you'll find anything in there that would align them with any of these hateful organizations.
In fact, they, one also has to appreciate their position, right? As they have to be, they shun and spurn a lot of the more hateful and zealous supremacists because they know how damaging those elements would be to their own organization. So they purposefully, you know, distance themselves and try to make it clear as line as possible. And naturally, it's precarious.
Yeah.
The line is not so clear. They're sponsoring them. They're their children. They sponsor them with money, and they create that hatred. And then they want to draw a line, yeah. And it isn't. The line
well,
isn't.
I defy you to point out in anything in their literature that could be called a
oh, yes, in the literature, of course. Yes.
It simply isn't,
it
in my opinion.
Interesting,
that's
when I was
part
a,
of the problem.
When I was a kid, when I was about 15 years old, I was staying with a girlfriend of mine in Florida. My parents were gone or something, and her mother was a member of the John Birch Society. We were having a meeting one night, and they invited me to go. And it was really interesting because I had no idea what it was at that time in my life, no idea where I was or what was going on. I do remember a couple of things that came up, and I don't know whether, you know, it's different now, but one of the things that came up that evening was we were given, our group, a flyer that had a picture of a white woman and a black man kissing, and under it was, you know, this, I remember exactly what it said, but a slogan about don't let this happen, you know, to your family. And it was very hate oriented, I thought, I mean, even then, and I didn't even know what I was seeing. And there were also, at that same meeting, lists of people that were being circulated in the group of people that were like blacklist type people. And there was a minister on there that my family knew very well, you know, that was supposedly a communist or something. I don't remember what his problem was. So I don't know. I mean, I tend to agree with, I mean, maybe they don't say go out and take out a gun, but.
Well, until they do, I think they should be given the chance to overstep that line. And it is a challenging proposition.
Yeah, well, Alan Berg would agree with you. I think Alan Berg would agree that they have the right to say whatever they want.
Well,
they have a right to print whatever they want.
I just think that the play is based on the order and makes that very clear. It doesn't go into any other group but the order. I mean, it does mention other groups, but it's about the order.
Thank you.
Thank you.